Good afternoon and welcome. Thank you for joining us today for this webinar, our mini-STEMposium to support teachers in the field. This is the ninth of 18 webinars we are hosting. This session has about 400 people registered for it. My name is Ken Heidrich, and I am the National STEM Manager for Accelerate Learning. I'll be your host today for this incredible afternoon of learning. I've been in K-16 public education for over 30 years. Connecting with educators in the field, like today, is the best part of my job. Thank you for being here. We have lined up some exceptional talent from around the country for these mini-STEMposiums. This week, we offered 6 sessions during the afternoon. We have 2 more tomorrow. We also will host 6 sessions during July 14 through 16. The link to the schedule is found in the chat window. Some of our national superstars include our presenter today, Dr. Oki Lee, and Roger Bybee, Peter McLaren, David Crother, Rita McDonald, Larry Plank, and Kelly Price Colley. We also have some local trailblazers from the Dallas-Fort Worth area, including Shane Woods, Linda Cook, and Malachi Edward. In addition, we also have some of our best presenters from Accelerate Learning and STEMScopes. As you know, these are challenging times. Accelerate Learning and STEMScopes want to support our hardworking educators by offering these sessions of high-quality professional learning. Nothing in return. We are just trying to provide some meaningful professional experiences free. We are trying to take your mind off the pandemic for a moment. Please note that the participation of our major invited speakers does not necessarily mean an endorsement of products developed by Accelerate Learning. We are in challenging times. The speakers, along with me and my colleagues, are here to provide a rich learning experience so that teachers can take back with them some useful information and strategies to their students. We are all in this together. Before we begin, let me share some procedural aspects to this webinar. As you know, we're using Zoom. You're probably very accustomed to it now, which has a number of interactive features. Please look at your sound and video controls found on the bottom left side of your screen. Your sound should be muted, which means there should be a red diagonal line through it. If you choose to display your video, please be constantly aware of what you are broadcasting. We also recommend that you use the speaker view on your video display found on the top right corner. Let's try a new feature now called polling. Let me release a quick poll to see who we have in the audience today. So I've launched the poll. Let's take about 20 seconds and go ahead and mark your response. What is your background? You folks are quick today. We're about 80%, give you about 10 more seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, let me close the poll and let me display the results with you. So this is who we have in our webinar this afternoon. It looks like we have primarily elementary, we have teachers K-12, it's almost even across elementary, middle, and high school. But it looks like middle school has edged out the others a little bit. We also have some campus administrators, which is great to hear this message on higher ed and some other folks. So thank you all for sharing that. I appreciate that. It's gonna help Oki and the rest of us understand what your background is for this webinar. Next feature is called chat. We will be using the chat feature today for your comments and questions. This window is being monitored by STEMScopes staff, and they will be able to respond to you when necessary. Our chief chat captain is Pam O'Brien, and she will be doing most of the interactions. We also use a Zoom function called breakout rooms. Our presenter will be able to randomly group people into smaller rooms for discussion. This has been a very valuable feature. Okay, that's it for our procedures. So today, I am very pleased to bring on Dr. Oki Lee. She likes to go by Oki, but she still is Dr. Lee to many of us. We're very happy to have her today. She has her bachelor's and master's degree from South Korea. She got her PhD from Michigan State University. She is currently a professor of childhood education in the Department of Teaching and Learning at New York University. And she's been doing that since 2011. She's published 106 articles in refereed journals. When you look at her vita, it is many pages long. She is very prolific. She has authored 5 books, including the current NSTA 2020 book on cross-cutting concepts. And her 2015 NSTA book is called NGSS for All Students. She has won numerous awards and honors, including most recently the 2020 NSTA Distinguished Service to Science Education Award. We would have seen that in Boston in April, but unfortunately because of the virus, it got canceled. But Oki Lee would have been recognized by a room full of people in the ballroom for her accomplishments. So ladies and gentlemen, please let us welcome Dr. Oki Lee for this presentation. Thank you. Oki, take it away.
Share screen.
Yes. Okay.
And I will share the screen here. This is my choice. All right.
Perfect.
Move things around and you are going to see my profile instead of the front face. That's my choice. There we go. So, hi everybody in the virtual space. Hi. Ken started with gratitude for you to join the webinar today. And I would like to echo his statement that I am truly honored that you're joining the webinar with me, especially during this time of the year where you are ending the school. Boy, it was a tough year and it's going to continue to be tough for some time. So I am going to just make a joke of it. Thinking about, I hope that it's not recorded. Ken, did I say right? No, all of those. You're so committed to improving science instruction for your students, but I have to tease you, okay. So I am going to talk a little bit about some ideas that I would like to ask you to think about for the summer so that you can plan for your instruction in the coming year, despite all the uncertainties. And I am going to push you to think somewhat bigger and better and more boldly than we have been doing, because I'm expecting, and I know that you're thinking, that we are going to have a new normal. And I hope that a new normal is a better normal for the future. So that's the intent of a pushing. Now we have a serious business to do. So I am going to start and I'm going to move along rather like a professor. Okay. So the first topic that I have is a framing of the presentation. Why does it matter? It's a little bit of a movie, Jerry Maguire movie, where Renee Zellweger tearfully said to the lead character that you had me at hello. So my goal is I wanted to have you at hello of why this session matters to you. Okay. And then you're going to say, I love you and you complete me at the end. So that's the goal of the two actors saying you had me at hello and you complete me. So framing of the presentation, science instructional shifts. So there is a science, there is a language instructional shift, and then we are integrating science and language with all students, including English learners. And then I'm going to add a computational thinking. So we cover quite wide terrain of a science language and integrating the two with a computational thinking. The first one, framing. Now, just giving a little bit of a state of the union about science and engineering education, we started the framework in 2012. Which provide the foundation for the NGSS in 2013. And when I was a member of the NGSS and led the NGSS Diversity and Equity team, the vision of the science standards is that it's all standards, all students. Okay, So all students. Now, right now, since the 2013, a time has passed and 44 states and DC have either adopted or made adaptations of the framework document. I would like to ask you to take a pause on 1 second and thinking. Before the framework in NGSS, my experience, the science curriculum that I developed in Florida did not work in any other state because the states had a different standards. It's a one state by state. This time, 44 states have adopted and we share the common language and common vision. And that means the curriculum that I developed in New York State is applicable to Kentucky, New Jersey, Colorado, California. Isn't that amazing? And it's all voluntarily. So that's what Ken means, that we are all in this together because we share the resources and expertise. I mean, that's unthinkable. If I may say, I'm from Korea, and what I learned about American education is all localized. Science education right now is voluntary collective work without the federal intervention. It's our intent to have a collective work. I mean, it's just that. I think it's just amazing. Now, so right now it's all about implementation of a curriculum, professional development. Now we experience the challenges because the standards are really rigorous and it's different. And that means it presents challenges. Another thing that is also very incredible that you take a pause for 1 second and say, wow, research that provide the foundation from the framework, policy that started from the NGSS and state adoptions, and then practice in the classroom, we are all speaking the same language. That is amazing. Before, policy did their own thing about accountability and testing, research did something about the small unit and you the research, and from the classroom perspective of policy standards, it did not apply to me, research did not apply to me. This time, we are all speaking the same language. I think it's incredible. Now, so we started from the framework in NGSS, and the most important, just think about the relay running. Where do you put the strongest runner in the relay? Possibly in the beginning, but where do you put the strongest runner in the relay? At the end. And who is that? You. The fate of a science instruction really relies upon you. The last runner to take the baton to the finish line. That's where we are. So I would like to ask you to think about your role, that it's not these people, it's here that makes it happen. Now, another thing, it's a standards, all students, and it's a flip. It's not just a shift. To me, it's flip, upside down. Why is that? Traditionally, scientists and teachers say, this is important science, and this is the science knowledge. Typically, it's written in textbooks. That's why literacy is such a bully, I have to say, because the students have to read the textbooks. And some students understand science, but for most students, science did not make any sense. Science is not for me. That was the traditional. Contemporary, it is a completely the opposite of a flip. Why is that? Because the traditional minority students are the majority. It started in 2013 when the science standards NGSS came out. That's when the majority minority flipped. By the way, do the census for the next decade of who we are. Okay. So this time it's all students, all standards. Students are making sense of a phenomena and design solutions to the problems like scientists and engineers. The mantra of the science standards is that if students can find information on Google, that's not worthy of instructional time. Later on, when we talk about the computational thinking, if a student can give the instruction to Siri and Alexa, give me the information, that's not worthy of instructional time. The instructional time is giving the command and making sense of. So it's a complete flip. Now right now, so there are all students broadening participation, STEM, including data science and computer science, And then technological innovations. It's very familiar to you, right? Because you are teaching all students, teaching science, STEM, using right now all technological devices. I mean, it's the reality. I thought that it would have been 5 years. It is right now. And we are not doing one at a time. We're doing all three of them. So that's why I'm trying to break the silos of I teach science, you teach something. No, we all do it together. So this is a one example of how the three areas are cut across. All students, in my case and in our work, we focus on English learners and then science, and we do computational thinking. So this is one example. So I am going to ask you to follow me through about how these three domains come together to say, oh, that makes a lot of sense. All right, so that's a framing of why it matters. More the case right now through the pandemic and a new, hopefully a better normal, because we are not going back to the past. Now we are getting into science and language and integrating. So science instructional shifts. I am not going to do NGSS 101. I am going to do NGSS applied to 301. So I would like to ask you, if you're not familiar, here is a framework document and NGSS. My fame of the framework is that I know the Dr. Helen Quinn, the theoretical physicist who was the chair. That's my fame relation in relation to the framework. And then here I am part of, actually I was a part of the research that went into the framework. So here are three instructional shifts. And any webinar or meeting that you attend regarding the science instructional NGSS, you're going to hear three instructional shifts. This is what's amazing, that we speak the same language for the same shared goal. Now, English is my second language, but I'm going to try that these are three instructional shifts in one sentence. Ready? It's going to be a complex sentence of a three altogether. Students are explaining, I didn't say teachers. Students are explaining phenomena in science, but designing solutions in problems by engaging in three-dimensional learning, which is a blending of practices, cross-cutting concepts, and disciplinary ideas. And their learning progresses over time as the students build a science understanding across time. That's it. That summarizes your whole years of a science instruction in three instructional shifts in one sentence. Okay. What does that mean? Phenomena. Phenomena is a new phenomenon in science instruction, and we think a lot about the what phenomenon that we are selecting with the students, because the phenomena should be really the hook, compelling. For me, phenomena should be you had me at hello for students. I'm really intrigued to find out. So it's a you had me at hello. That's a phenomenon. I think of a phenomenon that should be the students at the center. So what does that mean? We think a lot about local phenomena. Why is that? It's about equity. It's about the place. It's about me. It's about me, my place. That happens to me, not in an alien place. So I have something to talk about. I know what to say, and my ideas matter, even though I don't speak English yet, but I have ideas. That's equity. In terms of science, promote deep understanding, integrate science. Why is that? We don't teach phenomenon that is a physical science phenomenon. We teach phenomenon, and phenomenon commands the disciplines. The other way around. Any phenomenon can be physics science, physical science phenomenon. It could be bundling of a life science. So it's a phenomenon. It's a project-based learning. I'm going to ask you to think about this. I know that you just feel that, oh, I have survived the remote instruction. Never thought that I would do it, but I did it. And I survived, and you may say I have thrived. For that reason, I would like to ask you on your chat, to exercise your technological knowledge. How do you see the importance of a local phenomena for remote science instruction? And when I say remote, that means including parents, including the community, including home, including. It's about the place, not about the teaching science in school. It's just teaching science in their place. So I would like to ask you actually 1 minute to share your thoughts on chat box, of whether you have tried a local phenomenon with your students that also involve parents, community members, and siblings, and families. So 1 minute. Tam, you're going to help me, right?
Absolutely, and you have a lot of responses coming in right now. The first couple responses were really, there's a high relevance, it makes it more identifiable to students. It connects with students' background knowledge. It engages parents. Let's get students outside, citizen scientists, science for all, solving real world problems, solving local problems in a community, allowing students and parents to learn together, making science real.
I have a goosebumps right there.
And just so you know, you will have a record of this because I am not able to keep up with all these wonderful comments, so you will be able to see all of them, but we're just gonna keep going for a few more seconds. Building a connection to the world around us. Someone had a particular example of flooding in a local area and they had to create a solution for that, and it was right there in their community. Teachers involved with students, parents engaging in participation. And I love that because it's not necessarily just parents and students, but that teacher connection through the virtual world. Benefits toward inclusion of the community. How do you make a more inclusive environment?
Fabulous. So what I find really interesting is that education used to be in school, formal setting. Right now, education is on one end has been stretched to the family and home on one hand, which means a diversity. And then virtual and technology on the other hand. So it's a distributed collaboration and expertise of schooling in relation to home on one hand and technology on the other hand. Isn't that amazing? It just all happened within, 3 months. So Ken and Pam, you can see why I'm going for with the open, because I love about these ideas. Home, parents, a family, it's a connecting. It's a connection of a home, school, and technology. All right, thank you so much for your, and I look forward to reading your comments. It says internet is unstable. Okay, there we go. Now the second, NGS instructional shift is a three-dimensional learning, and it is a blending of core ideas that provide the explanations for why something happens, not knowing a lot of content. Practices of asking questions, develop models, argue from evidence, and constructing explanations. That's what we do science. And cross-cutting concepts of patterns. When you see the patterns, math has too much of patterns, and math standards actually don't emphasize patterns because it's all about patterns. You may know that cause and effect are not only the science, but also it's a ELA. Romeo pretended dying, and as a effect, what happened? Julia really ended her life. It's a character, it's all about the cause and effect. So these are cross cut. Haven't thought about that, right? These are cross-cutting concepts and not just a science discipline. It actually cut across all. Okay. And so we are bundling. And that's as much as I will say about three-dimensional learning and leave other experts to say more about it. Then we are getting into the shift of three coherent learning progressions over a science unit. And this is Brian Reiser's model. At first, I thought that Brian Reiser and his colleagues had a very pretty model of their model of learning progression. One day I sat down and I said, what is Brian trying to say here? So this is what he is saying. Phenomenon, something about sun and the body of water. So I'm thinking of evaporation. Leading to questions. And students engage in science practices. Now, this is a blue color, What does it mean? Practices are presented by blue, and there are hexagon, eight of them, because we emphasize eight practices. So it's not just the pretty. Each has a meaning in his model. Then by engaging in practices, students figure out, and students figure out, do you see that? Different co-idea, cross-cutting concepts, different colors, and then it's a puzzles. So puzzles fit together to explain. They have a meaning of every single piece. And then that leads to the next question, and the next question leads to, this time I think it's a classroom investigation phenomenon in the classroom. Next question. So it is a storyline of what happens. And this taught me one lesson. When we develop any model, any little element of a model has a meaning. Flipping it, when students develop their model, diagram, drawing, students have a meaning in every element of their model. So please give a credit to every little thing that students do. Sometimes they may do randomly, but often they have a meaning of why they do in certain ways. So here is a Brian Reiser that taught me model that taught me a lesson of really respecting diagrams and models. Now, coherent learning progression over time, here's something else to think about. It's over the course of a K through 12. This is a physical science. We do know the practice objects in darkness can be seen only when illuminated. It's a cause and effect of a light. We need a light that is causing to see. All right, that's a grade one. When you go to grade four, it's an object to be seen, the same cause and effect, a cross-cutting concept. But this light reflecting from object that enters the eye, that's a progression. It's not just that we need a light to see, but this time light is reflecting and up off the object and enters. By the high school, look at this. Reasoning and claim evidence behind the idea that electromagnetic radiation can be described either by wave model or particle model, and that. So if you miss grade one, if you miss grade four, if you miss middle school, students will continue having harder and harder time. This is why we need to work together for K through 12. And it's very important to think about learning progressions over time. So that is a science instructional shift, and we are moving into language instructional shift. If you are a language educator, you may say, I got it, down pat. Well, brace yourself, because as a science standard, that new language shifts are also new. And let me say why. I'm always starting from this idea that it's according to the elementary, every student succeed acts, which is a federal mandate of 2015. It says every student succeeds act. It says this. English language proficiency standards, it's like a science standards and math standards, so it's a language proficiency standards. There is something about listening, reading, writing, I can critique that at different proficiency levels. Then here is what is important. Language proficiency standards are aligned with challenging state academic standards. It's not science standards are aligned with language standards. So students are learning language in the context of content. Just think about it. We are teaching content. English learners are learning STEM. That means they are not required to have a language to come to STEM classes. They come to STEM classes and they learn science and they learn language. Now, when you think about this, that, for example, WIDA standards, that is applied by 35 states and four territories. WIDA standards, for example, were developed in 2012. And remember that when the NGSS were released 2013. So it's about a decade ago. And if ELP standards are aligned with the content standards, and WIDA, for example, was developed in 2012, and science standards were released in 2013, do you see that? So WIDA is going through the revision because it needs to be aligned with the state standards, which is the science standards. So science language integration. So this is what is really exciting. 12, 2012, 13. And there is a new standard, the English language, sort of like English learners in STEM subjects. It's a new way of thinking about the English language acquisition in October 2018. And for those, when you click on your website, these documents are available free online because you paid your taxpayers' money to support these documents. Don't buy them, just download them. So they are all in the transition of a framework and geoscience standards, and then English language learners in STEM subjects that are aligned, reflecting. So what does that mean? Science standards say that students are not learning science content typically written in science books. Instead, students make sense of phenomena and design solutions to problems as scientists and engineers do in their work. It's a knowledge in use, and it's what knowledge does. It's a function. It's not what knowledge is as a static body of knowledge. We used to think of science content as a static body of knowledge to master. No, we are using science to do something, using it. If science goes like that, guess what? Language should be the same thing, because the language should be aligned to content standards. So the flip of a language is that traditionally you have to know the vocabulary, you have to know the grammar. Contemporary, no, you come to a particular setting, you use a language, and language is something that does. Language is not what a static body of a language is. So in plain English, we used to think of it as what language is, as a body of a knowledge to learn, what science is, as a body of a knowledge to learn. Contemporary thinking, no, we are the masters. We use science, we use knowledge for our purpose. Fascinating, isn't it? So too bad, teachers are not masters anymore. Kids are the masters. And if we do not follow, students will say, Suri, find the information for me. They could actually bypass adults. Do you get it? I'm kidding. I'm kidding, but I'm not kidding. That's how fast the contemporary thinking is moving. So I will get there. And I will say computational thinking. For those who are staying, please stay, because the best is yet to come at the end. I'm saving the best at the last. All right. I hope that I had you at hello so far. Don't leave. You dare leave. Contemporary views on science and languages. So this is a short poll question. Which statement dictates a contemporary thinking? Vocabulary is a precursor and prerequisite. Students have to know vocabulary, so we pre-teach and front-load. That's what the language is typically done. Or language is a product of using language. So poll question. Use your knowledge of poll.
Okay, and let me launch the poll for everybody. You should see it now on your screen. Go ahead and please vote. A or B?
And we've got lots of people who answered in the chat, and that is absolutely fine, but go ahead and take the poll as well so we have a nice, accurate outcome.
Let's take about 5 more seconds. Most of you have responded. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, let me close it and share the results.
Predominantly, people would say language is a product. That's okay. And I do certainly understand the language as a precursor, prerequisite, because that is a current practice, and that's what STEM educators are being taught by the language educators as the common practice. So I am advocating, and actually I'm not advocating, the field is moving in that direction. So we are moving very fast to make the transition. I know that science educators and STEM educators embrace the transition, and language educators will embrace also the transition very quickly. So imagine language learning. We thought of vocabulary as a precursor prerequisite. So we take else out of the classroom and you learn the vocabulary before you come to science classroom. The contemporary thinking is that, no, you come to science classroom because of science standards. They say science standards are for all students. You come and you use any means of a communication to learn science. And when students see the purpose and have a meaning, they will communicate in any way. It may take a little bit longer, but they will learn the language to communicate their ideas. So it's not, what matters is not accuracy of a language, what matters of merit of science ideas. Merit of ideas. Okay. The second reimagining is that we thought of a vocabulary as the language. It's partly because we think of a vocabulary development as a foundation for concept development. We think of a vocabulary as a foundation for reading comprehension. Well, when you think about the science practices, or when you argue, you can argue without ever using vocabulary. You can develop model. Actually, when you develop a diagram, you don't even use a vocabulary at all. So we are using language in a much broader way than just the simply vocabulary. Vocabulary has a place, but it is only one component of language. We also thought of separate as language objectives and language of different content. So you do this and you do that today separately. No, we do it together. Okay, language in service of. Now, the next one is that we use the simplified language. So, and then by simplifying language, we also tend to simplify content. What do I mean by that? I have to say this though. Science is about the cause and effect. And cause and effect is something about the because of something happens, something, and something as a result. It's a complex sense. From the language perspective, a complex sense, they think of it as demanding. So what do you do to make language simple? You chop the two, one whole complex sense into two. The core, which is the essence of it. And in fact, and it turns into way more complex to put the two simple sentences together. If that's a science, why don't you just say it as a cause and effect? So that has limitations of level the readers. No. Once you simplify something, then you simplify content. Keep the rigor of standards, which is a support and challenge. So this is something that I learned recently. We tend to think of that we support English learners and poor English learners, that we even protect them. No, we actually challenge them just like any other students. So we need to think of a support and challenge. Now, integrating science and language, what does that mean? So we cover the sciences shift and language shifts. And so I am going to my favorite topic, which is some of you might have heard. So here is a science and language integrated language sale. And it is a work of my team, Apply the Linguist, and Apply the Linguist working with a theoretical physicist. It's a year-long fifth grade curriculum. We have a 4 units of physical science, but this is my favorite unit of a garbage. I will say more about that. And then garbage unit goes into the physical science. Those that do not decompose go into ecosystem, because the decomposition is a part of the ecosystem. Those materials that do not compose, do compose go to ecosystem, do not compose go into earth science, because plastic bottles are polluting our earth. And then space science, why do falling? Those are 4. And I'm going to focus on physical science unit. Now, it is my pride to say that this is one of the three elementary science curriculum units that receive the NGSS design badge, and that's how demanding to develop good science instructional units. So you can get the access to the unit, and it's fully available. Now, I would like to say a little bit about the instructional shifts that we do in science and language and how we combine. So the phenomenon, we are trying to have the students, you have me at hello. Phenomenon is our school, home, community make large amounts of the garbage every day. Have you thought about how much garbage that we make? It's a mind-boggling. And the driving question is, what happens to our garbage? As simple as that. So you may say, why would your students find this phenomenon compelling? But you have to make it work that way. So we are engaging students in three-dimensional learning by doing three dimensions of. So in the beginning of the school year, fifth grade students that come to the science classroom, the first science instruction, and this is what they see. Garbage on the tarp from the cafeteria, some of the garbage from their own school lunch garbage. And some students think it's really cool, and others will say, yikes. But whether they say cool or yikes, the result is that we got them. Because it's a never before. We got them. That's the main idea. So what happens to our garbage and what happens to our classroom? We cannot keep the garbage in the classroom, obviously, because it's going to be really bad. But when they sort the garbage into, they're already using language. Yeah, it's the same as this. So do you see that? They also do the body by sorting. And so it, in a sense, a gesture and body work is an extension of their thinking from the brain into doing it. They are doing science using language, but gesture is doing it. Now, what is, so it is a very language intensive, verbal and nonverbal. But also what is important is this. They are doing three-dimensional learning. And you may say, how so? When they sort the garbage into categories, well, sorting is analysis. They're analyzing qualitatively. When they sort into categories, that means that they are doing seeing patterns. Patterns of food and non-food materials. Within food, they are seeing patterns of food, softer food and hard food, or liquor or non-liquor. They are looking at patterns. So they are already looking at patterns of properties. Now, after we do the classroom garbage, we also ask students to go to the home and look into home garbage. We're also asking them to look into the garbage in the neighborhood. So when you have home garbage, classroom garbage, and neighborhood garbage, what are they? They are subsystems that make up the system of garbage. And they, all those subsystems go to landfill. So they are already doing system. Do they use the term system? No. But are they doing some system thinking? So continue, okay. So they are already doing core ideas and cross-cutting concepts and practices, analyzing, looking at the patterns and systems, and they are looking at the properties based on the patterns, based on the categories that they sort. Amazing, isn't it? That's the beauty of instruction, to make it happen so seamlessly as if they are having fun, but they're actually doing a lot of thinking as a foundation to continue progressions. All right, now, then the shift of three is a coherent science of learning progression storyline. Students build understanding. So we have four clusters. It's always framed as a phenomenon. Phenomenon, what happens to garbage? How do we smell? And why does it change? Cause and effect. So it's explaining. And then the phenomenon is as a context to learn science. So the two go always together. What happens to garbage materials? It's a properties of matter. Smell is particles are too small to see. Changes happened. I don't see bananas anymore because of the chemical reactions. Even though I don't see banana, about conservation, why did a banana slices disappear? Oh, something happened. So here is the storyline of the garbage unit. All right. What is really interesting is that this time science is not about giving a list of a science concepts. This time it's using science to explain why it happens. It's about storyline. So the storyline is that students are sorting the garbage into categories. So they're looking at patterns. They are looking at the system of garbage. Now they cannot leave the garbage in the classroom. So they are making landfill bottles. Now, do you see this? It's open. Again, there is a system, closed system. And they do the observations and they measure the weight and nice smell, but they don't know what happens and they measure and weight stays the same. But over about 3 or 4 weeks, do you know that banana has disappeared, but plastic stays? So really smart kids will say, banana has disappeared because it has decomposed. So I don't see it anymore, therefore the weight should be less. Very articulate. Another day, they come back and they say, oh, I see water condensation. There's something condensation has happened and there is new substance and weight should be more because there is new substance. Well, we measure, and I am an English learner and I don't know all these words, but all I know is it's a closed, the same weight. That's all I can say. Closed, the same weight. When they measure, it's the same weight. If a student, English learner, does it a couple of times, you can see the pride. I know science, even though I don't quite speak English yet. That's what's so important. Merit of ideas. Now there is a smell, so it is really a momentous time that students say, whoa, that's really bad. Do you know how bad the smell of the garbage is? Really bad. And we take it to the next level of saying that decomposition and then agaplate, and I will get to that when we do the computational thinking. So let's think about science and language integration by combining the three. Here's what is really important. Used to be that when a science teacher has English learners, you may say, I don't know English learner strategies, so I don't know how to teach English learners. This document says that, no, we are teaching science. Kids are doing science and they are using language. So what is really amazing is that it starts from phenomenon, practices, and engaging discourse. We are doing science. By the way, students are also engaging in interactions using discourse, registers, and modalities. And you may say, I don't know what that means. And then there are meaning-making resources like translanguaging and home languaging and how language works, and that's the way science textbook is written. So I have to know how science is written so that I can write like that. These are way later. It's a whole different topic that I'm not going to go into. Instead, I'm going to talk about the science and language and integration. All right, ready? So doing science, science first, and using language. We do know language shift, modalities and registers and interactions, the two together. They don't necessarily correspond. So you may say, I don't know modalities and registers and interactions. Science educators, you do those things all the time, even though you don't use the vocabulary terms. Language users, learners, educators use all these terms, but if we ask language educators, do you know what modality looks like in science? They will say, I don't know. So this is where the interaction happens. Modalities are linguistic. Am I talking? Mm-hmm. Am I using text? Yes. Am I using drawing? Yes. Am I using symbol? Right here, arrow. Am I using table? Right here. Am I using gesture? Yes. So when I'm excited, like that. Am I using any of those, all of those, all of those? I'm using them as a means to communicate. research means that we are using language for a particular purpose in a particular setting. Typically, we think of a language as everyday language. When I tell a joke, I may want it to use a real simple plain English. When I talk about science or STEM, I use a very specialized language, precise meaning. So throughout the whole time, you're not going to hear me talking inquiry. Why? Because the science inquiry was the previous standards, which is became sophisticated through science and engineering practices. So you're not going to hear me saying inquiry because I want it to be precise. I will rarely use hands-on because that was also in the past. Interactions. So the way we use languages are very different. One-to-one, one-to-small, one-to-many, one-to-groups-to-many. If you are one-to, okay. And then I have to include a one-to-virtual. I have people that I do not see, so I'm shouting to the wild. It's a different modality, different interaction, and we have to use a one-to-virtual. And it needs to be very explicit because I don't have the luxury of saying this and that. And this is typically what happens in writing. This happens, he and she and a teacher will say, I don't know what you're referring to. Who is a she, who is a he, what is this and what is that? So you have to be very, very explicit because we don't have a here and now anymore. It's a beyond the here and now. So this is how we use language, modalities and registers and interactions. And right now I'm doing all of those. So my mind is really busy because I'm commanding the language to communicate as effectively as possible. So let me think about the language shifts of how we do language as we learn science. And I'm going to pick this one as an example. So here is that and smell. What's that smell? Modality. When we ask students to draw the diagram, the first thing that they could do is that this is actually real. They think of a smell as a cloud, like cloud floating and coming to me. Some students may think that smell is like lines flowing to me. Now, at least you will see that red and blue are not simply pretty. Red means smell and air means blue. So there is a meaning of the colors. Colors have sometimes a pretty and sometimes meaning. This time it is random arrow, particle movement, random particles. Students are learning over time with the classical experiments, and now they are learning that particles move freely and reach my nose, and students are using all sorts of modalities, and their ideas have become strategically more sophisticated. Now here is the important part. Here is one example. One student wrote that the lines are the smell, how I can smell pizza in a lesson cluster. And so smell is coming to my nose. After about 2 weeks of instruction, the same student, you'll be very excited. Look at that. The same student, soil, foil, spoon, orange, banana, all that. Banana smell, it's a banana is yellow, and orange smell, okay, it's orange. So there are banana particles and smell orange particles, and they move randomly. Would you be excited within 2 weeks? This is where you say, my kids get it. I'm so excited. It's a closed system. You open it, you move, the particles move freely. This is where language can come in. You can say that, write your ideas in writing. Express your ideas in writing, which can even make the ideas more sophisticated. So I'm asking science teachers to go further. Traditionally, multimodality, English language education thought of it as listening, speaking, reading, and writing. English language education thought of it as poor old kid who does not speak English, she draws until she learns English. Come to science, you cannot think of anything without using science, graphs, diagrams, all that. So we need to think of modality. Science people think of all modalities. Language people think of reading, writing, speaking, and listening. And English learning education think of a poor old kid who does not speak. And we have to do all of them together. that English learners are using all modalities to express ideas. I'm not waiting until I learn English. No, I do science using any means of a modality. Now, register. So, ew, it stinks. Well, that's communication. That means that there is a smell, and it's a bad smell. It's a good start. Even this is a communication, means there is a smell. Yeah, it's a gesture. Yeah, don't underestimate the ee! If it's a nice smell, I love the smell. Do you see that? I wouldn't say the nice smell for really bad smell. That would be contradicting. So we tend to underestimate gesture. Now, so the teacher, this is where the role of the teacher comes in. If it stinks, why does it stink? Why? Is it something or nothing? If it stinks, students away to something. If it's something, then what is it? Is it solid? No. Is it liquid? No. What is it? It's not liquid, it's not solid. Oh, it is a gas. If it is a gas, if it's something, why can't we see it? Can't we? Why is that? Why can't we see it? It's there. So students are doing classical experiments to say, oh, it's a gas. Gas is made of particles. If it's a gas of molecules, how do we smell it? The students are learning that gas is made of particles and particles have moved. So students are learning that gas is made of particles that are too small to see, move freely in space. Now that's the fifth grade standards. Do you want to see what students will do? Here we go. All right, after 2 weeks of instruction. Ready? A student wrote. Smell travels freely. True, particles move freely. And the wind helps it get more spread out. Yes. You can't see smell because the particles are too small to see. Please give a hands up. Particles are too small to see, so you cannot see. But they move freely and the wind can help me better. And that's why I smell. Now you can do more linguistic accuracy of spelling and all that. And I would have liked that you can't see smell because the particles of a smell travels freely. I would have reversed the sentences. But guess what, in terms of understanding, would you be happy as a science teacher? Absolutely, fifth grade student. That's the power of it. So I'm not making up what I'm saying. Traditionally, this is where you have to know particles, and then we use the particles. No, instead students are doing all the science, and then they are learning about particles as a product of doing it. Okay, now thinking about the interactions. So interaction is that whether you are doing here, I don't see it here. It's okay, because I know what you're talking about. But if it's a classroom, you cannot say it, that you have to be very, very explicit. So explicit is really important. Traditionally, we thought of using language in a very formal way. So you say, yesterday we learned about something that starts with a P, 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 and students just learned about particles and you're expecting students to use the particles and that won't happen. Take time, let it happen. Eventually, they're going to say particles later, but don't say P, P, P. They're going to say particles are pretty, potty. I don't know what you're asking me to say. I'm guessing. It'll take time, right? So breakout rooms, I'm looking at the time, 15 minutes, and I used to have 4 minutes, and Pam, I think we are going to skip it. Would that be okay? Would that be okay?
Yes, Ken, what do you think?
It's totally up to you.
This All is right, great. 15 minutes. If I have the time, I'll go back, but because I said I save the best for the last, I would like to make sure that we have the best and that if we have the time, we'll go back. That's my strategic decision of a communication. All right.
Perfect.
So I would just say that here are three science instructional shifts, and here is modalities and registers and interactions all go together. As the science learning becomes more sophisticated, students use more modalities strategically, more strategically of a register, and interactions have become more explicit. Okay, so that's basically it. Breakout rooms, I consider that you have done it, saving 4 minutes. 5 minutes possibly, but we'll come back if we have the time. If we don't kill me, please. All right, so we are going to the next. I think we should have plenty of time for the next section. How are we doing so far? Thank you. I hope that I'm tantalizing your ideas and asking you to think about. So you have come this far of science standards are new, holy. Language shifts are what? So we are not going to do pre-teaching and front-loading anymore. We're going to use language to the science. All right. And then we are going to computational thinking because you're using remote instruction, using all sorts of technological devices. And when I think about the remote instruction, it gives me a little bit of like chill, got both the good and bad. Students have to come to the computer and they have to log in. They have the power of saying, I log in and join. Do you see the students have a more agency? Because you cannot say, come Johnny here, sit here, listen to me. You cannot do that anymore. So it completely changes the dynamics of interactions. And it'll continue to be. So get ready for technology. And we are doing computational thinking as a part of science and language. I'm not an expert on computational thinking. I barely manage it to log in. I'm kidding. But I'm learning from young people. They tease me and they joke at me. Okay, you have to know. Here we go. So here is a computational thinking. This time, we are working with the MIT, who actually own the domain. I consider them wizard of Oz. They make it happen beyond the computer screen or computational models. So they make it happen. We say, do this, and they will say, okay, but this is where it happens. And Vanderbilt colleagues do the research on how kids think. So again, this is interdisciplinary. We have to work together across disciplines. One cannot do. So you can see that we bring science and language, they bring the wizard, and then they do the research on computational thinking doing together. So I will unpack it. And this is a coming attraction to a theater near you in 1 year or two, because it'll come so fast. So here is a sale. Computational thinking and modeling. It's a modeling. It's a one part of modeling. Sale and Starlogo Nova. We combined the two together across the three institutions. So here is a Starlogo Nova. Now, I will do the plain English of a talking and bear with me, okay? Just like when we do the science standards, we do phenomenon and three-dimensional. When we do language, modalities and registers. When we go to computational thinking, here is agent-based and blocks-based. Every discipline has its own terms that are basic to each discipline. You may say, I know nothing about agent-based programming. What? Blocks-based programming. So let me do a little bit of unpacking in plain English. This is a programming. For me, that's a gibberish. When I hit my computer in a wrong way, I see all this gibberish on the right side and I close it right away because I don't know what that means. That's experts do. This is a Starlogo Nova. This is a blocks-based programming. What it means is that some of this goes into while toggled in English. Set my color, this is another block. Some of this will be combined into one. Forward, right by, do you see that this is English? The power of a computational thinking is that it's written in verb. Forward, backward, do it, because I'm giving a command to my agent that I'll talk about. This is also very plain English. When I think about microbes and decomposition, science loses to computational thinking because it's a plain English of doing something. All right, so models. Here is what we did, physical model and diagramming model, computational model. This is where all the magic happens. I'm giving the command, and my command appears on the computer screen. follow me. This is a really, really just a, wow. I'm giving command. When I give a command right here, programming, it happens. So this is a science of how microbes decompose apples and bananas. Here is weight of a banana, weight of a banana, solid gas, weight stays the same as a 500. The graph goes down, graph will go up and down, weight 500 units, banana, solid, banana gas. So here is an agent. I, a student, I'm a master, and I have my agents to carry out my command. Microbes, that's my agent. When microbes are in contact with a banana solid turns into gas, that's it. Thank you for looking at the screen, that's it. This is a time that our teachers say that my students really understand decomposition. Weight should stay because it's a confined, closed, and then it's the same solid gas. The same. Students are giving the command. This is a science. Let's think about engineering. So in Earth Science Unit, plastic bottles that do not decompose, see, I'm not using plastic bottles anymore. I'm using reusable to think about the Earth. It's a garbage unit contribution. It matters if I drink tap water, bottled water, students find out EPA standards and I can drink tap water and bottled water are meet the standards. Although Flint, Michigan is a different story, which is a social justice issue. So it's an engineering issue of if water is the same, why does it matter? Because plastic harms ocean animals. So this is where we bring ocean, and which is where we bring biosphere in addition to geosphere and hydrosphere and atmosphere to address. So here is something. Students are designing the solutions. Put more police officers, or make more fountains, or they have a solution. But this is a social media of doing something. Total plastic bottles, it's a polluting. This group decided to do social media campaign. People don't use plastic bottles because it's harming the environment. People, my agent, use a plastic water bottles, my agent. But when people go to the fountains, drink the water from the fountains, there is a 25 chance that people may convert to using that's engineering. And it has flattened the curve so that plastic consumption does not continue to go up. I'm using the words very intentionally, flatten the curve. Don't let the plastic bottles go exponentially spread. Contain it, because the plastic bottles are polluting, hurting, causing problems. So this is why, again, I'm going by Oki. I thought that this is really cool that our fifth grade students are doing this pollution, engineering in addition to science. All right? Are doing some sort of a remote instruction. This is the plastic bottles. This is from Washington Post of COVID-19 virus spreading. The same ideas. Spread of the virus, contain the spread of the virus. Plastic bottles pollute the environment, contain the pollution of the environment by the plastic bottles. And this is from Washington Post. So it will say that if we do extensive social distancing seriously, this is how long it takes. If we do lax, this is what it takes. This is what we see across all the states. Right now, this is the reality. Whoa, I hope that I have saved the best for the last. So we need to all come together. I would like to say that in the past, who comes to the table first is also an issue. I always would say that language education comes first, that you have to have the literacy, and they bully. And then possibly math comes second. Science, you can come later. Social studies, you have some crumbs. Computer science, we don't know what it is. English learner education and students with special needs, oh, we forgot. If we change the dynamics of it, English learner is at the center for all students, students with a disability. Well, computer science and math and STEM come first, and English language arts, you are in service of the disciplines. It's a completely different flop, and we should advocate students first, disciplines second, and literacy and language in service of. Literacy is not a discipline, it's a skill. Literature is a discipline, but reading and writing is a skill. It's not a discipline. So we are doing something the opposite. Do you see my passion? So I'm saying it. So we have 2 minutes left. Not enough for questions and answers, and I wanted to thank you for allowing me to talk the whole time. I wanted to have the whole range and 2 minutes, and we have 1 minute.
So Dr. Lee, I'd just like to say that you have many people out here who share your passion and are in agreement with you, and when you have an opportunity to read the chat, please do.
Thank you, Oki. That was truly outstanding. Your energy, your insights, your passion for getting us to make these instructional shifts to support English learners, it's very powerful. I liked how you are getting us to think about contemporary thinking and working with students. That was very clear from your talk. And you are a masterful teacher, and I love your use of wait time also. I think you have inspired us, so thank you, Oki.
I have 1 minute, so I would like to give 2 last messages for you to think about.
Absolutely.
30 seconds.
It's yours.
One, I would like to ask you to really think about a new normal and flipping the education system the other way, putting students first. And place, that is about equity and diversity. And technology for the future, and how we serve the future, that's one. The second, the reason why I'm passionate about it is that the ideas that I share is my own struggle to come up with a why. So if you think that something does not make sense, chances are your colleagues say, it doesn't make sense. It has to make sense. The power of the science standards that making sense of, telling a story of why. If it does not make sense, you are not getting it. Kids are like, it has to make sense. So my transition has been that when I was working and questioning the language, I said, oh no, not me. I don't have expertise about language, or not me. And then I asked language people and they did not know science, and science people did not know the language. And I said, why not me? Because nobody seems to know. And then that has gotten to, it's me. And now I'm asking people, it's us, to think differently. So I would like to ask you that if it doesn't make sense, chances are that your colleagues will say, it doesn't make sense. Build your momentum, work with the colleagues, and say, we have to make sense. Because if we don't make sense, kids don't make sense. So be bold. This is a time to be bold, because the new normal gives us the opportunity to be bold. Well, it's the time to be bold. Bold.
That's a great message. Thank you. To follow up for everybody, we will now post a link for a certificate of participation in the chat window. You must click on the link so you can download the certificate. It's a link that will go out to a Google folder. We also will post a short 5-question survey about this webinar. Please do take this survey. This webinar has been recorded and will be available on the mini-STEMposium website in the next day or two. A follow-up email from me will have a link to the handout from Oki's presentation today. So again, please complete the survey and you will get an email from me regarding a link to the handout. Please remember we have additional webinars this week. We have one starting in about 12 minutes with Larry Plank. We have 6 sessions in July. You are welcome to go online to mini-stemposium.com to register for those webinars. On behalf of Accelerate Learning and STEMScopes, we appreciate you taking time to participate in these learning experiences. Thank you and be safe.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.